All right. This week, I think I talked about this last week. Today is going to be, I'll spend a little bit of time talking about the midterm and reviewing for it, and take any questions that you have about that or anything that we've gone over. The remainder of time today, I'll spend talking about more jQuery stuff. Wednesday will be a work day, so you can work on whatever you want. If you choose that you don't want, you know, that you're caught up on the assignments and you don't feel the need to come in, you don't have to come in, and you could, if you wanted to, take that time to work on to do the midterm. All right. The midterm will be made available later today online, and you'll have essentially till Sunday to complete it. So you could take the 2 hours of this class and work on the midterm on Wednesday if you don't want to come in for the work day. Spend a few minutes talking about the midterm then. There'll be three documents in the midterm folder. There'll be something that says midterm instructions. There'll be a document called midterm, and then there will be a midterm Dropbox. The midterm instructions simply tell you the instructions for the midterm. In other words, it'll be available, you know, from whenever I enable it today until whatever the Sunday's date is, 3/12. You'll have 2 hours from the time you download it to upload your answers. It is open book and notes and internet. However, you can't collaborate with another person. And everything should be in your own words, all right? In other words, if I can copy and paste something from your answer into Google and I can find a page that says exactly what you said, that's not good. All right, you should put the answer in your own words. Let me know if you're not able to complete the quiz within the time frame. Put your answers in a text document that you can upload to the Dropbox. Plain text document, rich text format, a PDF, a Word document, anything like that is okay. The second document will be the actual midterm itself. And do not download it until you're ready to work on it. Because when you download it, that's when the clock starts for you to upload it again. I can tell when you have downloaded it. I can tell when you upload it. And then the Dropbox is where you're going to put your answers in. Okay. The midterm itself is going to consist of five or six conceptual questions. By conceptual questions, it's going to mean questions about, first of all, the purpose of things. You know, why do we even have something like client-side server, client-side scripting? Why do we even write code in a certain way? What does AJAX mean? How is AJAX different than the traditional model for client server? I ask these questions. questions, because it's possible to know how to do something if someone asks you how to do it, but you also need to know, like, why you do something certain ways so that you can apply it to new problems. So if you had a situation and you had a choice to do something client-side versus server-side, or you are looking at implementing some functionality one way or another, it's important to know the proper use of these things, client-side and server-side technology. You know, why you do things a certain way. So there's 6 questions along those lines. Being able to look at a portion of a statement and explain what it means. I might say document get element by ID, give an ID dot value, and you have to tell me what that means. All right, or dot style display equals none. What would that do? What, you know? So be able to explain some statements or portions of statements and explain what they do. Then the rest of the questions, there'll be 4 more questions where you're going to write snippets of code. By snippets of code, I mean I'll give you a web page with the HTML and stuff in it, and you'll have to be able to write the JavaScript to do certain things. You know, write the JavaScript code that makes sure that someone selected a radio button. Alright? Now, when you have to do that, you don't have to write the entire function or anything like that. You just have to do the segment that I asked you for. Alright? So you don't have to write an entire program or an entire function even. You just have to write the instructions that accomplish the very specific task that I defined. Write the instructions that will change the color of the div to yellow, for example, could be a question that you would ask, or that I would ask, that you would need to answer. So in a nutshell, 6 questions that are conceptual, and 4 questions that are relating to coding. I guess the lines are blurred a little bit between them. Some of the conceptual questions do contain looking at code and understanding what the code does. But as far as writing code, there'll be 4 questions where you write code, 6 questions where you don't write the code, but you explain something. All right? You have 2 hours for it. Needs to be your own words. It will be enabled sometime today. Wednesday will be a work day. If you choose not to attend on Wednesday, you could take the advantage of that time and do your midterm at that point. Any questions over that part of it? All right. Here's a question. And it's not on the midterm, but it would be a good question for the midterm. Shoot, I wish maybe I'll change it. I don't know. And add it. What does an if statement look like in jQuery? I know we haven't talked about this yet, but in a way we have. I don't know. Maybe we have sort of talked about this. I know we didn't look at a specific example. Someone say what an if statement looks like in jQuery. You are all absolutely right. All right. What do I mean by that? By saying that you're all right. You didn't say anything. How can you be right if you don't say anything? Oh, wait a minute. Did spring break start this week or does it start next week?
Next week.
Okay. Well, go ahead. Are we going to say something?
Are there no if statements?
Well, there's no such thing as an if statement in jQuery. Here's the important thing to remember. jQuery is an add-on to JavaScript. That means anything that you've done in JavaScript is still valid. All right, but you can also use the jQuery functionality. Let me look at the example we did last time, and maybe we can build upon it, or we can maybe look at another example. Example we looked at last time. Okay, here's the example we looked at last time, and I have to say I think there's a problem with this example. Take a look at the code and tell me what the problem is with this example. We got that covered. We got the way our ways of bringing the paragraphs back. What is clicking? What does this function do?
When you click the paragraph, it fades out.
When you click on any paragraph, it fades out. But this paragraph claims that it's not clickable. We can't make this one fade out. So I don't think that's right, because if we do this, it fades out. Alright, so based on what we were doing last week, that isn't correct. How would we fix that? Do you remember how we did fix that last week?
We put them in a class.
Remember, jQuery, a good part of jQuery is similar to the notion of selectors in CSS. Alright? Selectors in CSS, what do? They define what gets a certain style rule. All right. So we can define a style rule based on a paragraph, we can define a style rule based on a specific ID, or we can define a style rule based on a class. So really, we don't want all paragraphs to go away, we just want some of them. We want a group of paragraphs that are going to disappear when you click on them. We want a group of paragraphs that don't disappear. So whenever you hear that there's going to be a group of this, a group of that, in terms of CSS, and likewise in terms of jQuery, you're thinking of a class. So class equals, I'll call this one disappear. Class equals disappear. I don't absolutely have to give this one a class right now, but I'm going to give it a class because in a minute we're going to do something special with it. All right, how would we change this to make only those disappear, these first two disappear? Instead of P, we do dot disappear. We change the selector, in other words. And if you think about it, that's the same thing that we would do in CSS if we had a CSS rule. If we wanted all, if we wanted to change from all paragraphs being green to only certain paragraphs being green, we'd set a class and we would define that class. So this will do that, and probably for good measure, we should do this one as well. So let's save it, and now we'll look at it, and that one fades, but not this one. All right. Okay. So now we're sort of back up to speed with this. Let's yell at them if they click the one that doesn't disappear. All right. So I'm going to write a function that's going to yell at them if they click on this guy. Now, I'm going to write it, though. I'm going to write it using pure JavaScript. Not going to write it via jQuery. All right? Not going to use jQuery or anything like that. So, I'm going to put in an onClick method. And would I do this for real? Maybe not. But I'm doing this for a reason. I want to demonstrate something. So I'm saying onClick yell at user. I'm going to make a function yell at user. And this function is going to just pop up an alert box that says, I told you it wouldn't disappear. So now we view this. And disappear, disappear, boom, we get an alert. All right? This is, I told you it wouldn't disappear. By the way, I don't like alerts. I don't use them too often. All right? This was good to use here because I could do it without any mess or fuss. All right? And I do use them for debugging. If I want to see where it's at in a particular piece of code, I'll put an alert in to find it. But I could do that. I could do this. If you want to get rid of the alert, get the error message that way. My point is that jQuery is not like really another language. jQuery is an add-on to JavaScript. So I can mix and match wherever I see appropriate. And what does that mean? Well, that means a lot of good things. That means, first of all, if you are using if you find code examples online, it's not like they all have to be pure JavaScript or they all have to be jQuery. You can mix and match. Or let's say you're working on a project. Let's say the person that initially started the project did everything in pure JavaScript. and you're going to enhance the project, and you're not necessarily going to rewrite it from scratch, but you're going to enhance it. So to make things easy on yourself, you're going to do things using jQuery. You can mix and match. All right, so you can mix and match really any way that you want to. All right, to get the job done. So it's not as though if you do things in jQuery, you cannot write pure JavaScript, or if you do things in pure JavaScript, you cannot write jQuery. That was the trick question when I asked about an if statement. The if statements in JavaScript are there. All right, there isn't a special if statement in jQuery. jQuery is primarily used to query a document, all right, to be able to point to things in documents a different way and to add certain functionality to those things. All right. So, I could, and this I'm even using the onClick event, all right? I would say what I've done here, I did it to demonstrate that you could do it, but probably is not a good practice. Either use onClicks or don't use onClicks. Don't mix and match where you have some things that are defined as the document ready function and some things that are defined based on onClick. You can do that, all right? But I could see where that would get to be very confusing. So I would probably avoid that unless you had a real good reason to do it. All right? Really, what we have here are two ways to define an onClick event. One is through our code. We could actually write a pure JavaScript version of this. This isn't something magic due to jQuery. All right? But this says when the document is ready, perform this function. And what this function does is it adds a click event to things with the class of disappear, and it adds a click event to the thing that has an ID of button reappear. So I could add a click event to the things with a class of no disappear, put this in here, and we should be back in business. So the point is we could mix and match jQuery in whatever way you have that is appropriate. Some things you might want to comment, but again, other than that, it's up to you. Let's see if there's a way in jQuery to refer to the inner HTML. Actually, it is this. This is equivalent of document get element by ID. This is setting the HTML property. It's calling a method. And this is the argument. This is the value of the thing that we're setting the HTML property to. All right, there you go. The point is you can see in this example, even though this is like a three lines of code, we wrote it three different ways, right? Using jQuery or pure JavaScript for each step. And you can do that for anything that you do in jQuery. Let's pull down another example and convert it. I want to find the payroll example. If I can remember where that is. We're going to try to convert this to jQuery. Alright. First thing I'm going to do is I'm going to get rid of the onClick event. From a purist perspective, it's better to have your JavaScript methods set via JavaScript as opposed to coding HTML onClick events. So how do we do that? We make a onReady method for our document so that when it finishes loading, we are good to go. I definitely can see how this is confusing. All right, let's temporarily put this on the same line so you can see what we're doing. This is our selector. We're selecting the document. This is, we're setting the function that we're going to call when it's ready. What is the function? The function is what we are defining here. All right. We actually could put the name of a JavaScript function in there. We could put a function called loadPage, all right, and then we call that function. What this is doing is this is sort of defining a function without giving it a function name, all right. So we could put in the name of a function here. And that would be the name of the function that we would trigger when this document loads. Or we can say, yeah, I'm going to define a function right here. So the argument to that ready function is a function, all right? And that function, I don't have a name for. I'm just going to define it right here. It's a function, no arguments, and here is the body of the function. That's why it's useful to do this, and you have to be real careful so you see how all these parentheses and brackets line up. There are parentheses that go around the argument to the ready function. So the argument of the ready function is what? A function. So either you specify the name of a function, or you define the function right then and there. If you specify the name of the function, it's just the name of the function. All right. If you specify the function right then and there, you write function, parentheses, curly bracket to indicate the start, curly bracket to indicate the end. Okay, now what I want to do is I want to assign to the click method of the button, I want to assign right now there's no way to point to that button and click it. So I'm going to say button process. So, as part of my document load function, I'm going to point to BTN process. # BTN process. I'm going to define a click event for that. Now, I already have some of these functions written, right? So I don't really need to do this. Define a new function. I don't need to do that. I can put the name of the function. Well, what's the function that we click on, that we do when we click on the button? We call process form. Form. All right, so now we're good to go. All right. This is an older version of the function. It doesn't do the actual validation, but again, well, this actually is an older version of this. I will download a newer version and then we'll look at that. But we'll copy code from there to there. And that's the nice thing again about stub functions is it's very modular, so I don't need to change the general flow of this, I just need to change those specific functions. All right, so let's make sure this still works. Well, sort of does, but nothing happens. Well, let's see if we can figure out why. What did I do wrong here? Dollar sign is not defined. Go ahead. Yeah, I didn't point to the jQuery. I just started with my jQuery right here, and I didn't have any of that in there. So I have to go and put that in. So now it gives me a value of 0 or 165 because it's assuming, I think, $15 an hour. All right, cool. Let me go and get the newer version of this. associate, there, trainee, there. Okay. If we forget something, we get that message. Good. So we're back in business. So all I did really here is I used jQuery to assign a function that I already had written. Now, if we were going to redo this in jQuery, what we could do is we could look function at a time and decide, is it worth rewriting in jQuery or not? You know, we don't have to do it all. For example, this function right here, see if the validate form is true, and if it is, then calculate results. That's pretty clear to me. I don't see any way, any reason for doing that. This, on the other hand, I could go and I could redo this in jQuery by just using a selector. So I could say, for example, $IDErrorsHTML. You know what? I'm going to leave that as a comment, then underneath it I'm going to write the jQuery equivalent. So, like, which of those two statements are easier to understand? I don't know. I guess the jQuery is less typing. They're both pretty straightforward. It's partly a matter of what you're used to and what your personal preference is. All right? But those two, in fact, do the exact same thing. All right? Now, again, this likewise, we can do this. How do we get a value from a text box? It's the dot val method. Use dot val to get it. So I could say hours equals $ pound val. So JavaScript, native JavaScript, jQuery. All right, still works. One thing that you will notice, in the native JavaScript, we're pointing to an attribute of that object, the value attribute. Here we're using a method. In general, in programming, I had a good discussion with a student in my Java class about this, because we never address the attributes directly in my Java class. We always use methods. Why? That's a better way to do it, theoretically, because that gives whoever defined the classes more control over how the users, and by users I mean other programmers that are using the class that is being defined, how they access and manipulate those things. All right. So the purist in me says the jQuery version is better because we're not accessing the attribute directly. Attributes ought to be private. Attributes ought to be something that other programs can't directly access of an object. All right? You should have to use a method to access the value of a property, and that's what we're doing here. That just gives you more control when you are writing code, so that you can't set an attribute to have a goofy value. All right, for example. JavaScript is what's called a weakly type language, which means that pretty much anything goes. The variables, it sort of figures out what data type they are going along. By doing little things like this, by using methods as opposed to accessing the attribute directly, you're using a more standard and a more proper methodology for accessing the attributes. Now we could go and we could complete this. I'll do one more thing in here, and then we'll be done. Business. The bottom line is it doesn't matter to me whether you use pure JavaScript or jQuery. It's probably good to do a little practice of both. All right. jQuery is definitely advantageous for things such as those effects. So if you know, I would never write an effect to fade something in. I would use a jQuery effect for that. For doing something like validation or whatever, six of one, half dozen of the other. I suppose there is an argument could be made that if you're going to use jQuery, use it as much as you can. I don't know if I buy that. I mean, I don't know. It's a tough call. I think it's important. What I don't like to see is I've seen people just questions on forums like Stack Overflow and those kind of sites, where it's pretty clear that the person is asking a jQuery question where they don't know the basic JavaScript. In my mind, you'll be a better user of jQuery if you know the basic JavaScript. All right. I would not suggest learning jQuery first. That's why I don't teach it first, even though for many things it is easier to write the jQuery statements than JavaScript. It's better in my mind to get an understanding of the JavaScript, and then go and say, hey, well, by the way, for some things, you can make your life a little easier by doing this. So that's sort of my take on that. All right. That's all I had today. We'll see you on Wednesday.